The teachings of Jesus, are they accurate? Well, I've put these teachings under the most intense scrutiny for a lifetime, 58 years of intense scrutiny, really, even starting as a young person, very young. And first of all, I'd say that based on the premise that Jesus has, all his teachings are consistent with his premise, okay? Very consistent. Now, is the premise accurate? Well, under all the scrutiny I've put it under, and I can put something under extremely intense scrutiny, it's held up to scrutiny. So, what is a Christian? A Christian is someone who says, you know, I give the benefit of the doubt to the premise that Jesus has, and it is right, and my premise is mistaken. And so a Christian is someone who says, I need to correct my mistakes. I'm making mistakes because my beliefs do not align with Jesus' teachings and beliefs. So I am mistaken. So I have to correct my mistakes. That's a Christian. So a Christian is someone who is in the process of correcting their mistakes. Now what happens when the leaders of Christianity are making mistakes and not correcting them, giving us a wrong premise? Then you have a problem. So the beliefs of the leaders of Christianity, for instance the Pope, which is the most important leader on the planet actually, the premise that the Pope is operating under is extremely important. Is the Pope a real Christian? Is the Pope saying, you know what, this is the premise of Jesus, and I am out of alignment with that. I'm mistaken, and I am trying to align my beliefs, changing my premise to Jesus' premise, and aligning my beliefs with that premise. I'm working towards that. Is that what's happening? Now, Jesus told us that if you're a Christian, the world, meaning the world of the flesh, the secular, humanist, materialistic, pagans, that world is going to hate you. Hate is a strong word. And of course, in Jesus' life, the people hated him so much, they were constantly trying to seize him and kill him. So they have the world has a tremendous hatred towards real, true Christians. I mean, those who accept the basic premise of Jesus and are working to then correct their mistakes and realize, hey, I'm mistaken, not Jesus. And now, does the world hate the Pope, is the question. Do all the secular, humanistic, materialistic, atheistic, communistic, all the people who profess to hate God, hate truth, hate Jesus, you know, they can't stand it, the premise of Jesus, do they hate the Pope? Are they saying, Pope, you're so wrong, we hate you, why are you teaching people, you know, we can't stand your teaching? Or are they saying, oh my gosh, Pope, what you're saying is so wonderful, we love what you're saying, what's going on here? So Jesus said, if you profess the truth that I am teaching you, the world is really going to hate you. They're going to say, you are so, so wrong. You are so wrong. Okay. So it's very difficult being a true Christian in this world. Very difficult. You feel like the world doesn't really like you. And it doesn't. It doesn't. I deal with this simply by not having any friends or associates, or just keeping to myself pretty much, and play the fool, low profile, because I know if I tried to push my beliefs out into the marketplace, the world would hate me, you know, no question. Would be very antagonistic. Not popular, to say the least. Not popular, to say the least. So I've been watching this Pope, putting the Pope under some scrutiny. Not intense scrutiny, but some. And just a lot of things I'm noticing, like, wow. You know, wow, 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 wow. And now I see some more stuff coming up. It's just like, huh, there's a pattern here. And the question arises, is the Pope a real Christian, an actual Christian? That's the question. Because a real Christian says, you know, my beliefs are wrong, Jesus' teachings are right. And so the fault lies with me, and I need to correct my mistakes. I'm mistaken about beliefs. What is the fundamental teaching of Jesus, the clearest possible teaching of Jesus? And we get forgiveness. Now, looking into forgiveness, which I've spent a lifetime of doing, looking into forgiveness, what is Jesus really saying? And he said it very clearly, and he says, you must forgive others, because the truth is, absolutely nothing can happen to anyone of any age, of any condition, anywhere, any place, any time, under any circumstances. Nothing can happen unless you actually, at the level of spirit, choose that you experience this. So there is absolutely no cause to blame anyone for anything, which is what true forgiveness is all about. This is the teaching of Jesus. This is his basic premise, that we are absolutely free, and everything we experience, we choose to experience. Now, we're trying to separate ourselves from reality, from God. So in choosing this, it seems as though stuff happens to us without our wanting it to happen to us. But we're still choosing stuff to happen to us so that we can say to God, hey, look, I didn't choose for this to happen to me, something terrible. I didn't choose for this, so I must not be free. Therefore, I must have separated from your will, which is, you are free to choose what happens to you. So we're trying to con God, as it were. This is what Jesus tells us. So anyone who believes differently than this is mistaken, and they need to confess their mistakenness and say, look, it's tough for me to go along with this, but it's my mistake. I have a continuity fear. I have a hard time accepting that this is true, but I need to work on it. And so it is, I believe that Jesus is telling me accurately. I believe that Jesus is giving me the right information. So I happen to believe that Jesus is giving us the right information because I put it under scrutiny. And very intense long-term scrutiny, and it all holds up. It holds water. Very intense teaching, but also very true. So I consider myself a true Christian, because I said, I'm mistaken. You know, when I look at things and say, oh, isn't that awful? You know, all these tragedy stuff that's in the news, right? There's so much stuff, and you say, oh, those poor people, you know, horrible, terrible. And Jesus would say, no, that's not true. That everything that happens is a choice, choosing to experience that. Without exception. He says there are no exceptions to this whatsoever. This is his message. Now, how many people in the world profess this message? I've heard only maybe a few people say this, actually. You know, there's some students of A Course in Miracles who profess this. In some way, it may not be as strong as I would like, you know. But other than that, you know, you don't hear this. You don't hear it. Which means there aren't really many Christians in the world. But throughout history, there have been some that said, no, it, you know, there's nothing to forgive because no one did anything to me against my will. It's impossible that anything happened to anyone against their will. They have to have chosen it. This is Jesus' teaching, period. There's no wiggle room on this. Jesus says no exceptions, no exceptions. So I say he's right, Jesus is right, and I accept what he has to say. And there are no exceptions to it. So you might ask, well, why then did all this terrible stuff happen? Because we're trying to prove that there are exceptions to it. We are trying to prove that there are exceptions to it. To prove that we can separate from the will of God. See, our goal with all this existence and form, time, space, is to separate from reality and create a separate reality. We want to be a prime creator of a new reality. So we're trying to separate from the will of God. We're an extension of the will of God. We're trying to separate from it. The will of God is that we're totally free to choose our experiencing forever and forever. Always in the moment, we are choosing our own experience. So we're trying to prove we're not free by choosing these terrible stuffs, you know, shootings, tragic shootings, etc., etc., and say, look, there's no way I could have chosen that. Obviously, my will is not free, meaning I must have separated my will from God's will. This is why we're doing it. At least this is how I see it at this moment, and perhaps it'll become even clearer, but there's no question that there are no exceptions to what Jesus says. There are no exceptions to reality. And it certainly appears that the way the world functions, it seems to be trying to generate all this evidence for exceptions to this, which means that we've separated from God's will, which is our whole desire. So, of course, our desire is going to give rise to evidence that our desire it can be fulfilled. Now, the Pope, who's supposed to be the good shepherd, which is who's supposed to hold all Christians, Roman Catholics, and particularly, to the standard that Jesus set for us, to say there are no exceptions to forgiveness. Nothing can happen to anyone against their will, against their choice. Impossible. To say that that is possible is to say we can separate from the will of God. In other words, sin against God. Jesus says it's impossible to sin against God. It's impossible. And so here we are saying, oh, no, 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 here's an exception. This is an exception. This is an exception. We can sin against God. We can. In other words, something can happen to us against our will that we didn't choose. But Jesus says this is impossible. This is his central teaching. Central teaching. This ultimately liberates us because if we realize nothing can happen to us against our will, okay, also nothing cannot happen to us against our will. Bad stuff, we can choose stuff we don't want, try to prove it. We can also choose what we want. There's a freedom in it that we don't see clearly enough in this position. We may think that, oh, it's a terrible position to say, okay, even the bad stuff we're choosing. Yeah, we could also choose to not have it happen to us. You see, we can choose to have it happen to us. We can choose to not have it happen to us. We're free. So when we recognize, we accept, yeah, I chose all this to happen to me, I can say, great. Now I can choose to not have it happen to me. I can choose something else. And so that's wonderful, liberating, saving news for us, actually. There's not some force outside of us that's forcing itself upon us. Nothing ever forces itself upon us, even with babies and children, etc. No exceptions. But the world is busy manufacturing presumed exceptions. Now, the role of the Pope would be to insist that there are no exceptions. Okay, we'll be to insist upon it. And he says, look, I don't care what the world thinks. I'm not a shepherd of the world. I'm a shepherd of the believers, of the sheep, of the flock, of the faithful. So I am the one who's supposed to hold them to the standards and tell them what the standards are. This is what a Christian is. This is the standard you're held to. And if you don't like it, you can leave. All right? I'm not trying to bring the goats in and say, hey, goats, hang out with the sheep, it's fine, no problem. If you want to believe that they're exceptions, great. We're all inclusive here. That's not the role of the Good Shepherd. Does the Good Shepherd invite the wolves into the flock of the sheep and say, hey, wolves, it's okay, come on in. We're all inclusive here, we're tolerant, we're liberal, we're progressive, come on in. There's no worries. Is that the Good Shepherd? Is that the Good Shepherd that Jesus says, hey, you're the one, I'm putting you in charge of the sheep because I know you're going to protect the sheep. You're going to tell the sheep what are the standards you're held to so the sheep can work on changing their beliefs, changing their premise, get over the continuity issues and fears about this. Is that the kind of shepherd that Jesus would choose? Is that what Jesus would do? Hey, No worries, you know. You want to make exceptions and believe that, fine, that's right, that's also true. Is that what Jesus would say? No, he would not. He would say there are no exceptions. So what are we doing? What are we doing here? What's going on here? Is this the religion of Jesus, or is the religion of man, of flesh? The religion of the ego, making exceptions. Again, what I get from Jesus' teaching is clear cut. There are no exceptions. That is the root teaching. There are no exceptions to truth. And our belief that there are exceptions to truth is actually an expression of our desire to separate our will from God and say we have a separate will from God. And this, Jesus tells us, is impossible. This is a fantasy. It's a fantasy of fear, actually. So you cannot please both truth and lies. You cannot be pleasing to both truth and lies. You cannot be pleasing to God if you're trying to be pleasing to lies. It's not possible. So if you're trying to please the world, what are you trying to please? You're trying to please those who believe in exceptions, which is expression of desire to be separate from God, which is not religion, it is not salvation, it is not the path back, it is not the faithful, it is not the repentant, it is not those who admit they're mistaken and need to change their beliefs, it is those who are proud and insisting on that there are exceptions, which really means that they believe they can separate their will from God. Those are the ones that are unrepentant ones. So why would anyone who leads the repentant, faithful, be trying to please the unrepentant? And say, yeah, oh yeah, sure, yeah, but of course there are exceptions. Of course these people are wicked, of course they're bad. Of course these are victims. Of course a victimization is true. Of course, who is that trying to please? Is that pleasing Jesus? I guarantee you it is not. It is not. So who's it trying to please? And what kind of confusion does that bring to the faithful? They say, hey, wait a minute, I guess my faith in Jesus, oh, well, there are exceptions. Okay. What kind of shepherding is that? Now, it is true, you get the shepherding that you ask for. So, you know, the Catholics are responsible for their own experiencing, each one of them. So, everyone is. So you get the teachers that you want. So it would be evident that a lot of people want teachers, shepherds, who don't teach them, don't hold them to the standard that Jesus set for us, which is an expression of their continuity fear. You know, but it certainly isn't helpful, especially when you feel, you know, that you there's a tradition of obeying, you know, the Pope. It can get very tricky. But I would say more and more and more people have to start asking themselves, you know, who is the shepherd here? And how am I being shepherded? How am I being cared for? And I say, wait a minute. You know, whoa, wait just a minute here. And so I'm seeing more and more and more and more and more and more and more of the attitude of, let's open the doors to the wolves here. Let's bring them on in. The wolves being at lies. And the paramount lie is that there's an exception to truth, that victimization is possible. That's the lie. Because that would prove that our will is separate from God. Because in God, in reality, it's impossible that anything happened to us against our will. Because we absolutely, moment to moment, in this completely smooth, seamless way, are choosing our experiencing. That's how God created us. So it's impossible that anything happened to us that's against our will. So it's impossible that we be victimized. So what is the Pope doing going around apologizing for victimization, okay? That's trying to please the world. The world loves that stuff. See, the world loves to hear about victimization and believe it. That's why the news is full of all this crime and victimization. This is what the world loves, because it seems to prove to them that our will is not free. Therefore, that means that we somehow managed to separate our will from the will of God. See, because we couldn't possibly have chosen all this victimization, so-called these things to, you know, bring harm upon us, so to speak. We couldn't have possibly, no one could have done that. Not true. This is the lie of the flesh, the lie of the world, the lie of the ego, the self-deceit that we're engaging in here. Now, it's one thing to try to find line, and it's another thing to step over that line. And one might even question, has the Christianity ever been taught correctly in the world, actually? You can go back and ask that question. Has any pope actually been a good shepherd? Has any Christian leader been a good shepherd? Has any Christian leader taught, you know, the real teachings of Jesus? There is no such thing as victimization. It's impossible. Has that been the central teaching? It should be. It most certainly should be. So has there ever been that teaching? You know, has that been the teaching? Or has it been an attempt to, you know, please both truth and lies? Well, certainly there's been the flavor of forgiveness in Christianity. And Christians have tried to extend forgiveness. And many have succeeded to some extent. So that there's certainly been undercurrents of that in Christianity. There's no question about it. That we try to say, you know what? I must have chosen this. It's difficult. It's real difficult to do this. But you have to work at it. And I've worked at it my whole life. And I've recently saw how I chose these various lives that I've had, and how I've put myself into terrible positions and caused suffering and all this intentionally. I did it to myself, maybe for misguided reasons, but I did choose it. Nothing's happened to me against my choice. I made bad choices, but that's still my choice. It's not forced upon me, because ultimately there was this desire to, you know, separate the will from God, to see what that's like. So I'm responsible. See, I am responsible for my experiencing. Everyone's responsible for their experiencing. At any age, an infant, a toddler, a child, you know, teenager, adult, old person, no exceptions. That even includes death. We choose death for ourselves. Nobody forces death upon us. We don't actually have to die. It's a choice. This is also true. God did not create death. It is something that we are choosing to experience. And we don't have to choose to experience it, actually. So now, of course, let's say the Pope taught the truth and held Catholics to this standard that Jesus holds. Those who want to follow Jesus says, you must be held to this standard. You must hold yourself to this standard. What would happen to the number of people in the church? It might plummet. Well, maybe that's what they're afraid of. But there's the bigger question then, you know. You save the institution but lose the souls. Save the institution and lose the souls, as it were. You know, is that a victory? Is it a victory to have a great institution where the teachings are erroneous and no one's being held to the correct standards and nobody's really making any progress at all? In fact, they're reinforcing their delusional belief that they can separate their will from God. Is that a victory? just because the institution still stands, you know, or is big and prosperous? Is that really a victory? What kind of victory is that? What kind of shepherding is that? Is it a victory when the sheep pen, all the sheep are in the pen and the wolves come in and they devour all the sheep, so the pen is now full of wolves, and you say, well, I still have the pen and there's still lots of animals in the pen, you know, is that a victory? You know, at what cost? That's a Pyrrhic victory. Is that the kind of, is that what Jesus would do? And when you say Jesus comes back and they say, okay, Jesus, you're the head of the church now, Catholic Church, let's say. Is that what Jesus would teach? Jesus teach, you know, everybody, what did Jesus say? Hey, everyone, you know what? There are a lot of exceptions. There really is victimization. You know, things can happen against your will. See, is that what Jesus would teach? And if that's not what Jesus would teach, then why is it being taught? Isn't the good shepherd supposed to teach what Jesus would teach? So when Jesus came back, and they would say, here's your church, Jesus. I've taught them correctly. I've held them to the correct standard. And Jesus would say, absolutely, you have. Well done. Great. So a lot of spirits that have repented and are ready for the final, you know, take the final step to see the vision of oneness. You know, they're ready for the vision of oneness. Or when Jesus comes back, would the Pope say, hey, Jesus, you know, look, there's a billion people in the church, really rich, money's coming in, and they're thriving, we've got a billion, 1.1 billion Catholics here, Jesus, look how successful we've been. And Jesus said, well, what about the standard? You know, he says, oh, well, you know, look how many people are accepting, you know, the church, it's prosperous. You know, it is what Jesus says, but the standards. I said, well, you know, we're good people. Yeah, we're good people. We give food to the poor. We're good people. Try to be good people. And Jesus said, isn't that the Old Testament teaching that you're following? Trying to be good people, right? Didn't I say I came to bring a New Testament? Didn't I say you need to drop the Old Testament teachings and follow the New Testament? New Testament I'm bringing you. I'm bringing you a New Testament. No, don't put new wine into old wineskins. Isn't this whole thing about I'm trying to be a good person, isn't that Old Testament teachings? Isn't that legalism, right? Legalistic teachings? I need to do this good to get into heaven. I need to do this. Is that my testament? I don't want an Old Testament church, I want a New Testament church. I want the people to say, hey, there are no exceptions, there is no victimization. Hey, I'm mistaken. I need to change my premise. I need to repent. I need to say, God, I was trying to separate from you. I was trying to separate my will from you. And by believing that tough stuff could happen to me against my will, as proof of this, and I realized I was stupidly, foolishly, whimsically mistaken in this, and I'm very much... I have suffered from this, so would you please send the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Truth, to me, and so I can learn from this and I can evaporate my continuity concerns so that I can drop this ridiculous effort that I've been making. That's the New Testament teaching. So we can just let this, you know, reverberate and say, huh, wow. Now we know what the answer is, don't we? We can see what's going on, actually. You know, doing good works is great, but if your premise is wrong, it's like putting lipstick on a pig. You know, it's still Old Testament church. If you're teaching charity and insisting that victimization is real, that's putting lipstick on a pig. Can't you teach the truth that there's no such thing as victimization, and also do good charity? Can't you do both? Of course you can. So isn't putting lipstick on a pig an attempt to disguise the pig, right? Saying, hey, look all this charity work we're doing. Look how we're austerity. You know, I'm living a very austere life, doing charity works, helping the poor, all this. Isn't that an attempt to distract from the fact that you're also teaching victimization, which is really a desire to separate your will from God's will, belief that it's possible, belief that something can happen to us against our will. That means our will separate from God, because God's created us, and nothing can happen to us against our will. So all this emphasis on works, is that not a smokescreen, which is attempting to, you know, obscure the false premise that is being presented? You think Jesus is really fooled by the smokescreen? God is fooled? Jesus is fooled? Is that really true? So who are we fooling here? We're only fooling ourselves, unfortunately, and we don't want to do that. The Good Shepherd is not supposed to help people fool themselves. It's supposed to teach the truth, even though it hurts. Of course, it hurts to say, I'm mistaken. You know, I've been engaged in this foolish, very foolish misadventure of trying to separate my will from God's will. Trying to prove it's possible and put myself through all this suffering to try to prove it's possible. Well, you know, gosh, I don't want to do that anymore. And God will say, great, you know, that's great. You're free to do it, but I'm really happy to see that you realize you're free to not do it also. See, you're free to not do it. Because really, I didn't really create you to try and, you know, prove that your will could be severed from God's will, my will, by torturing yourself. That's not why I created you. See? So the teachings of a good shepherd should be unequivocal. They should start out the mass. This is the teachings of the church here. Okay, folks, this is why you're here. These are the teachings of Jesus. Okay, victimization is impossible. Start with that. Okay, just start with it. Victimization is impossible. Any belief in victimization is a belief you can sin against the will of God, that something can happen to you against your will, is the belief you can separate your will from God's will, which means a desire you want to be greater than God. That is spiritual pride. Any belief in victimization is spiritual pride, and that's what you have to drop. So we're here to drop that spiritual pride. We're mistaken. You've got to start out the Mass with that. So make a statement of what we stand for here. This is the standard. And if half the people leave, half the people leave, you see? Otherwise, they're not clear what it is they're joining, what is their, you know, what standard they're being held to, and what's the point of it? What's the point of it? Be popular? Who are you being popular with? Are you being popular with Jesus to not teach the truth? How is that popular with Jesus? So who are you trying to please is the question. The ego? It's an expression of continuity fear, isn't it? So start out the Mass. This is the standard. This is what we believe. Profession of faith. They do have a profession of faith, but you know, some of the stuff in there is good, but it could be a lot clearer. Start out with, hey, we profess that victimization is completely impossible, no exceptions. Start out with that. Now, of course, the world of secular humanism would have an embolism if they did that. They go completely insane. They go berserk if you did that. Let them go berserk. You know, that's what they're going to do. They would be literally frothing like mad dogs. Literally. Well, that's what they would do. So let them do it. But Who are we trying to please here? Are we trying to please mad dogs or Jesus is the question. Jesus says, if you don't profess that you know me and teach the teachings that I've given you, then I don't know you. You know, you don't know me, I don't know you, so to speak, saying, hey, Jesus says, when I come back, you know, who's been professing the truth in the world? And who has been trying to be popular? And those who have been trying to be popular said, I don't know you. I don't know you. Okay, what he's saying is, you don't know me. So there's not a recognizable relationship there. There's still the relationship of oneness, but we don't recognize because we're trying to be separate, our separate will from the will of God. So we don't feel as though we're one. So for me, I say, wow, I don't want to be among those who say that Jesus says, I don't know you. You know, so I was like, well, that scares me. You know, it's like, wow, I don't want to hear that. I'm always scared of that. I say, wow, I don't want to hear that. You know, that's means I've been lazy. So every day I'm thinking, you know, I got to be more courageous. I got to be able to, you know, don't hide your light under a bushel. You know, speak the truth in this world. But I don't know if Jesus will say that he knows me. I don't know that. But I'm just, you know, I'm just trying to correct my mistakes is what I'm trying to do. So every day, work harder and harder at it. Say, wow, I gotta be sure of this here. This is important. So we have this marriage between the Pope and secular humanism. At least a marriage, a flirtation, you know, a courtship taking place for sure. And I said, wow, you know, that's not how it should be. The secular humanist press and commentators and everyone should be screaming at the Pope, says, we hate you. Your teachings are hateful to us. Then we say, wow, I got something there. Your teachings are hateful to us. What do you mean there's no such thing as victimization? That's our key concept. What are you talking about? The world can be divided. The sheep and the goats can easily be divided between those who believe that victimization is possible and those who profess it's impossible. Clear-cut division there. Absolutely clear-cut division. Now, of course, those who say it's impossible, they will say, well, we admit there's a lot of stuff that plausibly could be spun. You could spin it and say, how is that possible? It's hard to believe it's possible. And yet we say, for sure, it's impossible. Therefore, they had to have chosen that as a very, very desperate attempt to try and prove that their will is separate from God. You know, by choosing some horrible fate, you know, to the body and saying, look, I couldn't have possibly chosen that. Yeah, that's the motive behind it. So even though we say, oh boy, I wouldn't choose that, you know, there are those spirits who choose all sorts of stuff, all sorts of fate for the body, you know, that we wouldn't necessarily choose at all. They do choose it because they're so desirous to be greater than God, they're willing to, you know, to do that. They're so desirous to prove that their will is not free, so they can prove that they've separated from the will of God. You see, that's why they choose all these gruesome fates for the body, as well as, you know, innocent bystanders. You wonder, like, why does just someone like the recent thing in Isla Vista, you know, I used to live in Isla Vista, you know, so yeah, I know what Isla Vista is like. It's not a place you necessarily want to live, okay? I didn't like it. But I know Isla Vista very well. And to get innocent people just walking to the grocery store, you know, shot, you say, you know, how? They couldn't have chosen that. It's impossible. No, that's not true. It's not true. The fact that someone, quote unquote, is an innocent bystander, they chose to be at that place at that time. And they chose, for whatever happened, their body to perish. They chose that situation for their body to try and give the impression that it couldn't, they couldn't have possibly chosen that. Therefore, their will must be separate from God. That's why. It's hard to explain each and every situation because we're so inventive and creative at the ways that we meet our demise and have things happen to us that seem like, wow, there's no way I could have chosen that. We're very inventive and creative. It's like we've turned our creativity towards trying to manufacture false evidence. So of course it's difficult to, you know, it's just astonishing all the different ways. And we almost can't help but conclude, you know, that there's got to be some exceptions here. There's no way, you know, that this baby, you know, happened to be right there. How could they have chosen? Well, remember, it's spirit that is choosing form to be where it is, what it's doing, etc. The mind of spirit. It doesn't matter whether it's a baby or an old person or a young person, teenager, young adult. It doesn't make any difference. The mind of spirit is still totally in control of everything that. Choosing everything that happens on all levels. Nothing is excluded from this. Now, of course, the feminists will go ballistic about this, you know, saying, because rape, you know, they say, there's no way, see, this is the key to feminism, saying there is no way that a woman chooses to be raped. That's impossible. This is the cornerstone of feminism, which is really feminism, radical feminism, actually. I actually support feminism. I don't support radical feminism. There's a difference. I absolutely support feminism, of women being self-responsible, strong, independent, you know, take the spiritual path. You know, all of this, very much so. Stand on your own feet. If you don't want to have children, that's great. All this, I'm a big supporter of feminism, but I'm not a supporter of radical feminism, because the radical feminism is really the cornerstone of the new world religion, of what's taking place in this world, which says the whole thing is built on this premise that it's absolutely impossible for a woman to choose rape, or, you know, to experience rape. It's totally impossible. Therefore, it's a fundamental tenet of radical feminism that this for sure is an exception to our free will. We could not possibly have chosen this. Therefore, what? We obviously, our will must be separate from God. Therefore, we must work towards building a better world here, because we cannot have our awareness return to the vision of oneness and knowing what the isness of reality, which transcends form, actually. That's the cornerstone of the New World Religion, radical feminism, which is really, the United States of America is being run by radical feminism. That is a fact. Foreign policy of the United States is run by radical feminism. And radical feminism is the Antichrist teaching by using the issue of rape, insisting. You know, you see it constantly in the news. Rape, 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 rape. Whenever we try to get our attention back to truth, rape, 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 rape. Nonstop in the news. Terrible rape, brutal rape, right? And what they're telling you is, hey, those who believe in forgiveness, that nothing can happen to you against our will, look, this definitely happened against our will. The whole premise of feminism, radical feminists, are against our will. I think there was a book written, Against Our Will. So the entire premise of radical feminism is stuff does happen to us against our will, which is Antichrist teaching. It's not teaching Jesus at all. Totally opposite. That's the cornerstone of the new secular humanistic agenda in the world, actually. That's the cornerstone. See, a real feminist would challenge a radical feminist and say, you're wrong. You're wrong. See, a real feminist is a woman who thinks for herself. It doesn't allow radical feminists to dictate to her, this is the party line, this is what you have to believe. They say, hey, I'm an independent thinker. I'm going to think for myself. I'm going to look at this and scrutinize the situation for myself. I'm not going to have men tell me how to think, and I'm not going to have you, radical feminists, tell me how to think either. Because you sound just like, you know, meet the new boss, same as the old boss here. Say, forget it. I'm going to examine this, give clear scrutiny of the teachings of Jesus, teachings of truth, the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to find out what's true. Because if it is true that I choose all my own experiencing, I can also choose not to experience it. See, so it puts me in control. Real feminism is to make everyone realize they are in control of their experiencing, whereas radical feminism claims that rape happens to you against your will, against your control, you see, which takes control away from you, totally away from you, and puts all your, then you believe there's some power outside of you that can force itself upon you, and then you then go looking for strong leaders to protect you, and then you get this nanny, big mother world government state is what you get, which is what radical feminism is leading towards, is this extreme totalitarian big mother state. So again, the real feminists will say, hey, I'm not going to buy that line from anybody. I'm going to say, what is the truth? I don't care if some radical feminist tells, hey, sister, what's the matter? You're against the sisterhood, you know? Hey, don't you realize we're getting power? We'll share the power with you. Say, hey, I'm not buying anything. Okay, I'm not buying what you're selling. I don't care. You can't do this old line about solidarity, sister. You know, hey, we all got to pull together. That's just more BS, isn't it? That's just the same old lying politics that has always trapped everyone on this planet. You say, no, I'm going to think for myself. I'm going to listen to the voices of truth. Whatever I get, whether male or female, doesn't matter. I'm going to listen and clarify the truth. And I'm going to find what the truth really is, and then I'm going to recognize my mistakes, and I'm going to correct them. That's a real feminist, you see. That's what I support. I've always supported. Feminism was H-I-J-A-C-K-E-D by radical feminism. Very much so. The real battle is between those in the world who believe that something can happen to us against our will, that victimization is possible, and those who assert it's not possible. That is the difference in the world. It's not between male and female. That's not the difference in the world. The difference is ones who believe in victimization and those who don't believe in victimization. That is the difference between sheep and goats. It's not male and female. But females have tried to con all the women. The radical feminists tried to con all the females on the planet and say, hey, definitely you know that rape has to be victimization, right? Therefore, you know, and tried to, how could you possibly argue against that? You must be crazy if you do. So they pressured women in that way. And then, of course, when women accept that there is victimization, then they tell men, hey, you're evil if you don't believe that. And so the men cave in as well. So it's like caved in the whole belief system of the planet, basically. There's no such thing as victimization. That's the teachings of Jesus, period. It has to do with murder, rape, kidnapping, everything, you know, terrible you can think of. It has to do with everything. No exceptions. No exceptions whatsoever. So either victimization is possible or it's impossible. Clear-cut difference. Clear-cut difference. Now, what would a true Christian or a true person of faith say? They'd say, wow, okay, I intuitively, spiritually know this is correct. And so I know I have a hard time. I've got to change my belief structure. I've got to, you know, it's a tough road to align with this perfectly, but I got to get to work on it. That's all. That's what a real Christian does. Stop blaming people for, you know, how you feel. Stop believing in victimization and say, let's get to the truth here. Let's correct these false beliefs we have. Let's repent. Let's say, God, I know I can't separate my will from you, so I gotta drop all this idiotic false evidence that I can. That's stupid. That's the sheep separating the sheep from the goats. It's not a male-female thing at all. Women are just as capable of repentance as males. Just as capable. But the radical feminists have tried to persuade women that definitely victimization must be possible, because look at rape. See, how could you say you could choose that? See, that's impossible. They've tried to con, and it's a very powerful argument that's used with women. They have a hard time pushing that away, whereas men, not so hard, because men realize that there is this dynamic. Say that, you know, men would say, well, wait a minute, you know, you, is not quite as you describe it. The whole thing is not he said, she said thing. It is often the attempt that women say, hey, you did victimize me. And the man said, no, wait a minute. You know, there was both parties to this situation. And then you said there's being victimized. What's going on here? So men say, well, not so easily swayed by this. But whereas it's easier to get women to say, oh, yeah, I was victimized. You know, so there is that, you know, disagreement and dynamic there. But the bottom line is either victimization is possible or it's not possible, period. So it's easy to say which side do you stand on. So let's stop this, all this nonsense, all this gender war nonsense that the radical feminists have fostered, okay? Let's stop all this nonsense right now and say, which side of the fence do you stand on? See? Because again, if you admit, you say, yeah, I am responsible, everything happens to me, I'm also responsible for what doesn't happen to me. You see? So you really have, you've accepted the power of your life, actually. You're in control of your life now. Not some government, not some, you know, patsy leader, you know, not some puppet leader. You're not giving your power over to some leader to protect you from something that's outside of your control, which is exactly what they want you to do. They want to be in control of you is what they want, because they want to generate more evidence of stuff that can happen to you, quote unquote, against your will. They want you to believe it's possible so they can do bad stuff to you, but get you to choose to agree to that, you know, so they can pursue their pride in believing they can be separate will from God. That is the real agenda, the New World Order, the radical feminist, this whole secular humanist agenda, is to get more evidence to get you to believe, you know, that all this really terrible stuff can happen against your will, to actually get you to agree to have it happen, to convince you to keep on generating all this false evidence. That's what they really want. Whereas if you admit, yeah, everything, I've never been victimized, everything, I've chosen everything, then you can say, hey, wait a minute, I can choose to not have it happen. I can choose to not have it happen. I'm free. I'm not under your spell. I'm not going to agree to that stuff. I don't want to experience that anymore. That's not my purpose, so I won't. That's what they don't want to happen. That's what they're very scared of, terrified of. Because they've got such a bad continuity fear that they're afraid to even think about repentance, you know. But you don't have to keep playing that game. Nobody does. If they want to keep playing it, then they're going to have to keep playing it with the players that they can get. But don't let them get you. Don't let them get you. So the good shepherd should be standing up for the flock. The good shepherd should be standing up for the flock, not for the wolves. The wolves are the ones that want to get for you to say that, oh yes, victimization is possible, because they want you to keep playing the role of the victim is what they want. That's what they want, you see. So they can keep generating more proof that it's possible to separate their will from God, so they can believe they can play the role of prime creator. They're on an ego trip. They're on an ego trip, severe ego trip with severe continuity fear. They haven't been working on it. See, you don't have to play that game with them. Don't play that game with them. That's what the wolves want you to do. They want to keep playing the victimization game. And say, no, there's no such thing as victimization. Everything that's happened to me, I chose, and I can choose for it to not happen to me. Pfft, game over. Game over. You see, when you accept that everything has happened to you, you chose. Didn't happen to you. You chose it. Then game over. Because you can say, hey, now I choose to not, to have it not happen to me. And that includes birth, being born into this world. It includes death, it includes all of that. Game over. Just like that, game over. The wolves will have to find someone else to play. They'll have to play with themselves is what the wolves will have to do. You know, you're not playing the game anymore. So this is what I want to hear from the priests, the pastors, the rabbis, everyone throughout the world, the Pope, the bishops, leaders of every religion, leaders everywhere. This is what I want to hear. So I go to church. I'm waiting to hear. Where is this? Where is this talk? So I'm just giving this example. Hey, everyone, you know, why don't you give this talk? You know, talk like this. What are you afraid of? Pride, isn't it? And continuity fear. So you haven't been doing your homework, been lazy, essentially. So what are you doing leading the flock then? What are you doing shepherding the flock is the question. Well, they want you to shepherd them, right? That's why, you know, you get what you get the teachers that you deserve, actually. So it's an apostate world, you know, really, this place. It's an unrepentant world. But we're trying. A Course in Miracles, Jesus tried, you know, give him credit for trying. You know, how successful has it been? I don't know. I don't really can't assess that. It's maybe it's permeating, gradually trickling down, you know, through the more porous rocks it trickles down. And I don't know if anyone talks like this. I don't know. I've not heard anyone talk like this. I'm frustrated, so I'm talking like it. You know, I'd rather have someone else talk like this. But I don't hear anyone talking like this. So I say, my gosh, it's ridiculous. What kind of world is it where we're not able to talk like this? It's ridiculous. It's a total apostate world, you know? You can't even talk and say, hey, the difference between the sheep and goats is clear cut. Either you believe that victimization is possible or you don't. That's the most obvious thing that possible to talk about when we talk about truth. Either truth is true or it's not. And either there's an exception to truth or there isn't. It's cut and dried. There's no wiggle room there. So you start out with a profession of faith. You don't start out with wiggle room. You don't say, everyone, come on in and let's wiggle around here so everyone's comfortable. You say, folks, this is what we're here for. Okay, we're here for repentance. This is why you need to repent. You've been believing in victimization is possible. It is not possible. Therefore, we need to make this big turnaround, right, in our lives, in our belief. Big turnaround here. So we're here for the big turnaround. That's why you're here. There's no wiggle room there. People feel uncomfortable. We'll sit down and relax, and we'll gradually evaporate the continuity fear so we can realize we can accept the truth. And we're not scared to experience the great happiness this will bring us. Because we're now free to not have all this terrible stuff happen to us. So we can choose happiness, absolutely. So I'm so sick and tired of nobody speaking the truth in this world. You know, it's pathetic. It is just totally shocking to me. Totally shocking. I don't hear anybody standing up professing this cut and dry like this, you know. I'm being careful and PC, and I don't want to upset the radical feminists and the whole secular humanistic monster, you know, and I want to be popular. You know, I've never been popular in this world. You know, it seems like it's impossible to be popular. Yeah, but really, again, I mean, where are those standing up saying, hey, yeah, okay, this is my stand, this is what I stand for. Now, you don't have to profess in your family, because that could rupture relations in the family, and don't necessarily, I'm not advocating that. Because there is a pragmatic fact to that. So, I know Jesus said that no one can follow me unless they leave their family. I understand what he's saying. Family of belief, false belief. But for me, I feel like, you know, we don't have to necessarily push everything on our family members, that kind of thing. They're kind of a captive audience, actually. And I don't believe that this should be taught to a captive audience. If people should come of their own free will, come to church, come to teaching, hear a profession of faith of their own free will, and they're free to leave too. Whereas a family is a very much a captive audience kind of situation, and you know, it's not the best situation to try and, you know, force that upon family members. We cannot sin against God. It's impossible. So how could God be angry with us? It's impossible. We cannot separate our will from God. So how could God be angry at us? We're not separating our will. So we can point to it and believe it ourselves. God doesn't believe any of this evidence we're generating. Not one bit of it. Don't even look at it. He knows it's impossible. So God is not seeing, paying any attention to all the gruesome stuff we do to ourselves to try to prove that our will is not free. That this was, you know, we don't have, not paying any attention to it. God sees us as we truly are. Not paying attention to this ridiculous play with form, time, space, form, trying to prove that stuff happens to us against our will. God's not paying any attention to that. God's not angry at us in the slightest bit. God is this perfect happiness, perfect love, perfect freedom, perfect bliss, perfection, just absolute radiant glory, constantly, as is all creation. So God's not the slightest bit angry, not punishing us, not judging us, nothing like that. We're just playing this completely farcical, silly game with ourselves, that's all. So, you know, again, you have to stand on one side of the fence or the other. It's impossible to sit on the fence on this. It's impossible. So, if Jesus is coming back soon, so to speak, you know, you better decide which side of the fence you're on. Don't try to sit on the fence. Hey, Jesus, I'm on the fence. There is either you believe victimization is possible or you believe it's impossible. There's no fence. Either believe that there can be an exception or no exceptions to this. There's no on the fence. Either there is or there isn't. So just decide which side of the fence you're on. Profess it. Just profess it. Make a profession like I'm doing. You know, profess it. Make a profession of faith, public profession of faith in some way, or to yourself, you know, make a profession of faith to yourself and maybe a comment here or there, you know, say, hey, this is where I stand. And then know, oh, you know, this is where I stand. Then know that you are either with truth or against truth, trying to be against truth, trying to separate from God. Know which side of the fence you're on. And of course, we're going to feel uncomfortable with it. If we didn't, we'd be enlightened. We'd already be enlightened as far as, you know, we'd be experiencing the vision of oneness. There's no discomfort in that, that is for sure. But we'd certainly realize that taking this position in this world, this apostate world, you know, is like, wow, you know, I'm not going to be on anyone's A-list, you know. I don't think I'll be invited to the A-list parties, right? Won't be able to hang out with the celebrities. What a shame. What a shame. Won't be able to hold political office. Oh, what a shame that is. Won't be popular. Oh, that's awful. Of course, the payoff is tremendous because you can choose to not have all this stuff happen. You can choose to not have the world happen to you. You can choose to not have the universe happen to you, so to speak. Experience the universe. You can choose to not even experience the world, not experience the universe, not even experience form, time, space. You can choose to not experience that. You can choose to not experience birth. Your birth can be over. When you realize this, it's the end of your birth. Of course, death is part of that birth, isn't it? End of death. You realize eternal life is what you realize. You realize the vision of oneness, which is a vision of eternal life for all. The everywhereness of everywhereness. So the payoff is complete splendor. Complete splendor is the payoff for this. And by choosing that you believe in the victimization is possible, the payoff is continued agony, terrible nightmares, continuous terrible nightmares. That's that payoff. And who wants that payoff, actually? You know, payoff is pride, the pride in suffering. So, you know, I hope that I hear this someday from someone else in the world. Yes, who wants to be the only, you know, the only voice in the wilderness? Nobody does. Nobody does. I want to hear this intensity from many others in the world, absolutely. So let it permeate, let it permeate, let it permeate, let it permeate. All right. I guess it's time to wrap this up. Appreciate those who have listened to this and considered this. Again, which side of the fence are you on? Very simple stuff. Okay, very great. That's it.